Shri Gurubhyo Namaha, children.
Today we are going to discuss about the effects of war. So under that we are going to discuss about new geopolitical power alignment, nuclear proliferation and international agencies. These are the three topics we are going to discuss today. First one, new geopolitical power alignment. World War II changed the world in many ways. The world was polarized into two main blocks led by the superpowers. So one led by the United States and the other by Soviet Russia. Then Europe was divided into two, that is communist and non-communist. Next, our topic is nuclear proliferation. Proliferation means multiplication. The United States and the Soviet Union entered into a race to have more nuclear power weapons. Though they built a large stockpile of such weapons and they utilized all their resources to increase their nuclear weapons, both US and Soviet Union. Now third one, international agencies. Many international agencies, in particular the United Nations, the World Bank and the International Monetary Fund, came into existence and it provided a forum for all the countries, whether it is a large country or a small country. Colonial powers were forced to give independence to former colonies in a process called decolonization. So India was the first to achieve independence. In subsequent years, many countries were given independence. After Hitler came to power, the Jews people were persecuted in many ways. So they were deprived of their civil rights and even their properties were confiscated. So the word Holocaust, it is used to describe the genocide of nearly 6 million Jews by the Germans during the World War II. So some poisonous gas will be let in gas chambers and their Jewish people will be there. They made Jewish people to enter that gas chambers and they let some poisonous gas. So through that they killed nearly 6 million people, Jewish people especially. Hitler was able to play on the anti-Jewish feeling, which were common in Germany and also throughout Europe. Universal Declaration of Human Rights. So in the aftermath of the Holocaust, the UNO in its charter, it decided to promote universal respect and observance of human rights and fundamental freedoms for all without any difference to race, sex, language, religion, etc. So the UN efforts to protect human rights on a global basis resulted in the constitution of UN Commission on Human Rights. The Universal Declaration of Human Rights was its important contribution. So the Universal Declaration of Human Rights set forth fundamental human rights in 30 articles. So the UN adopted this historic charter on December 10th, 1948, and this day, that is 10th December, is observed globally as Human Rights Day. And a major outcome of the Holocaust we discussed in the previous paragraph was the creation of the State of Israel as a homeland for Jewish people. Our next topic is New International Order. In 1941, the United States and Britain began to give serious consideration to the need for international cooperation. Through that, it decided to achieve peace among all nations. And also their motive is to maintain international economic and financial stability. These two also were their important objectives, and this resulted in the establishment of United Nations, World Bank, and the International Monetary Fund. In that, first is United Nations. The first initiative for the United Nations came from United States and Britain in 1941, and they issued a joint declaration known as the Atlantic Charter. So this declaration of the United Nations was accepted by 26 countries which were fighting against the Axis powers. Axis powers means Germany, Italy, and Japan. And the Charter of the United Nations was signed on June 26, 1945 by 51 nations. India, which was not an independent country during that time, but it also was a signatory to the charter. But at present, now the United Nations has 193 member states, and each one, big or small, has an equal voting power in the UN. Now the General Assembly and the Security Council. General Assembly and the Security Council. The United Nations functions almost like government through its principal organs, which are similar to the legislative, executive, and the judicial wings of a state. So in the same way, the General Assembly is the body in which each member state is represented. This General Assembly, it meets once in a year and discuss about the interests and points of conflict. If we take the next one, the Security Council, it has 15 members, 5 countries, the United States, Britain, France, Russia, and China. These 5 countries are permanent members. And there are 10 temporary members who are elected in rotation. So these two bodies, they act like a legislature. So major issues and conflicts are discussed in the Security Council. Now, administrative structure. The executive wing of the United Nations, the UN Secretariat, and it is headed by the Secretary General. The Secretary General, along with his cabinet and other officials, runs the United Nations. And the Economic and Social Council, that is called ECOSOC, ECOSOC, it is the fifth organ of the United Nations, and it is responsible for coordinating all the economic and social work of the United Nations. Activities of the UN. Over the decades means 10 years, United Nations has expanded its activities in response to the changing problems facing the world. So in 1960s, decolonization, it was a major problem and it was an important issue. And then human rights, the problems of refugees, climate change, gender equality are all now within the control of the activities of the United Nations. Here, UN peacekeeping force, it has acted in many areas of conflict all over the world. The Indian Army has been an important part of peacekeeping force and has been deployed in many parts of the world. Next one, World Bank. World Bank and the International Monetary Fund. These two are referred to as Bretton Woods twins because both were established in the year 1945 after the Bretton Woods Conference in 1944. So the two main organs of the World Bank are the International Bank for Reconstruction and Development, that is IBRD, and International Development Agency, that is IDA. Together they are referred to as the World Bank. Next, post-war welfare states in Europe. After the war, the Labour Party was voted into power in Britain. Now, post-war welfare states in Europe. The term welfare here refers to the concept that the government is responsible for the social and economic welfare of the people. So, after the war, the Labour Party was voted into power and also it promised to undertake steps to look after the people. So in 1942, Beveridge report was published in UK, and in that it contains a series of measures which the government should adopt to provide basic needs for the citizens. Legislation was enacted to provide free health coverage to the citizens through the National Health Service and monetary benefits. So the benefits can either be achieved through cash transfers like old age pensions and unemployment compensation or through free services. So in addition, these countries also try to minimize economic disparities by collecting and through progressive taxation by taxing the higher income groups at relatively high rates. So these were the steps taken by Europe for the welfare of the people after the World War II. So in this lesson, we discussed about the causes of World War II, course of the World War II, and effects of the World War II. Thank you, children.